Dear friends, as our peace God calls us into our worship time together, let us gather ourselves in the presence of our life-giving and loving God on this, our holy day. As we prepare our hearts and minds for worship, connected in community with God and one another, our candles will be lighted today by Nate and Zach Amy. Grace to you and peace. Welcome on this day that our God has made for us to be together. And welcome to any who might be worshiping with us for the first time. And special thanks to all of those who are sharing our message for today. And Alice Gregory will be at the organ as Susan Barrow is on vacation today. And she'll be playing the hymns. And the guitar choir will be offering the responses. By faith, let us come now, bringing all that we are and all that we hope to be as God's people. And I invite all who are able to please rise as we sing our hymn of praise. Let us offer our prayer of invocation and confession together. Let us pray. life-giving God, greatly to be praised, wiser than despair, refuge and strength, tender and just, healing and forgiving, guiding and blessing. We come into this present moment, bringing all that we are and all that we yearn to be. Forgive, we pray, all of our sins and separations, for we have done that which we ought not to have done, and left undone that which we should have done. Empower us to hold fast to that which is good, and to your glory, holy and eternal mystery, we lift our songs and stories, praise and prayers, tears and joys, from this time forth and forevermore. Amen.
Friends, we have the assurance of faith that nothing can ever separate us from the love of God made known to us in Jesus Christ. We are forgiven, and so we are empowered to sing, Amen. We praise your name, O God.
Amen. We praise your name, O God.
Hear these words from the Hebrew Testament, Prophet Micah, words that Jesus would have committed to memory at a very early age. What does God require of us but to do justice, love kindness, and walk humbly with God? And these words of Jesus from the Gospel of John, love one another as I have loved you.
We give thanks for our Deacon Emeritus David Graham, who's been involved with the conversations on race for a long period of time, and for our Board of Mission and Social Action, and all of the ways that they raise our awareness of justice and peace in light of the teachings of the prophets and Jesus in the Bible. Eddie Graham will now offer opening remarks as chairperson of our Board of Mission and Social Action.
During the past year and a half, we have all had to do things differently. Mission and Social Action met on Zoom, as did most other committees in this church. This past spring, our church did not sponsor Lenten suppers and seminars, so Mission and Social Action decided to participate in a five-week seminar called Merciful Conversations on Race. Let's talk about white privilege. This is a seminar produced and written by the United Church of Christ in hopes that this learning experience would lead to important, challenging conversations and meaningful change in the participants and the people we would be working with. Each week had a unique purpose and process to address a critical topic related to the subject of white privilege, from looking at the big picture to writing an autobiography through the lens of race, whiteness as norm, impact of white privilege, and becoming an ally, or where do we go from here? Several months ago, Craig Mace presented to our congregation his biography through the lens of race. Today, three others will give their reflections on this seminar. Alice Gregory will go first, Bonnie DeBlois, and then Yvette Susan.
Hear these words from the Gospel of Matthew. In everything,
Do to others as you would have them do to you, for this is the law and the prophet. What is systemic racism? In my opinion, it's a sterile academic phrase that describes racism that's built into our everyday lives that we don't even recognize, and that's intended to keep people down and keep us apart. Many of my New England, or in the case of David Graham, Minnesota friends, tell me that they weren't really aware of racism, had little contact with people of color growing up. But even that demonstrates to me that racism was here, because being separate is one of the biggest symptoms and one of the biggest problems. As part of the Merciful Conversations on Race, an important part of the program, and I admit what I've addressed but not yet completed, is to write your story as regards race. It was interesting to hear other stories of growing up in a very segregated New England or small town Midwest. I'm sure no one thought of it as segregated, but that's how I heard it, because I grew up in a very segregated Jim Crow South. What do I remember of that? I always knew that we had a large black community in Jacksonville. I saw African Americans in town and in shops. But my neighborhood was white. My school was white. My church was white. My mother grew up there pretty poor. But the black neighbors that lived not too far away were poor. And they were segregated into an area of the south side of Jacksonville called Tiger Hole. And when she was a child, if a black neighbor came to their house, they went to the back door. Unspoken rule. I remember asking my grandmother why there were separate water fountains, bubblers for you guys, for white and colored patrons at W.T. Grant. Her response to me was, "That's a good question." Now, I truly believe I'm not a racist. I'm not. My mother absolutely taught me that I'd know better than anyone, and she had a heart that loved everybody. But I also know race was part of our culture in the South. It's part of our culture in America. And understanding it and figuring out how I can make a difference is what led me to work with Dave and Benny on the White Privilege Lenten series we held about 3 years ago, and to sign up for this seminar. See, I don't believe it's enough to say that I'm not part of the problem. I need to be part of the solution. Craig Mace spoke on this after the seminar, and he said it was like a light bulb turning on when he realized that just smiling at and greeting people who are different makes a difference. A place where my white privilege can be used in a positive way, I'll never again let someone make a statement that I believe is racist without calling it out, uncomfortable as that may sometimes be. You know why I say it's using my white privilege? Because statistics show that people are more likely to listen to this white grandmother than the person of color that their statement hurt. And they're more likely to learn from it and not repeat it. Wow. I believe that people sometimes perpetuate insensitive ideas because they just don't think. And letting them know how it sounds to you just might help them rethink it. Like when people say that we all have the same opportunity, and some people just don't take it. I've heard many times in the past year referring to the pandemic that we're, quote, all in the same boat. Have you heard that? Well, we're not. We may be sailing through the same storm, but I sailed on a pretty comfortable cruise ship, not a crowded lifeboat. I don't live in the inner city like Central Falls, the epicenter of the pandemic in Rhode Island. David and I were privileged to be able to work from home throughout the pandemic. People of color are more likely to have jobs where they can't work from home, like the wonderful CNAs in the nursing home where my mother was in Jacksonville. Every one of them was African American. They couldn't stay home, and I will be forever grateful that they didn't. And some of them got COVID. In one of the books the Mission and Social Action Committee read last year, The Warmth of Other Suns, in talking about immigration and black migration to the big cities up north, the author acknowledged that there was prejudice against large groups of immigrants from Europe,
I bet we're all familiar with the chapter in history during the potato famine, when immigrants looking for work were greeted with, "Irish need not apply," right? What I never thought about, and we were certainly never taught, is that by the next generation, their children, who look like me, were absorbed into the American melting pot. That was not, and still is not, true for people of color. That, to me, was really eye-opening. The Merciful Conversations on Race seminar didn't pretend to have all the answers or solve all the problems. Ideally, it would be a diverse group, racially diverse, gender, age, coming together to have open conversation, to foster more understanding, and to create a more diverse community. Many people don't have the opportunity to have real interaction and particularly open conversation with people of diverse backgrounds and who are of a different race. I sincerely hope that this and other efforts will grow because our community, our country, and the world will be richer for it. Ultimately, why I chose to be a part of this conversation and why I will practice what I've learned and continue to learn was said best by a Jewish scholar 2,000 years ago. You are not obligated to complete the work, but neither are you free to abandon it. Amen.
Hear the words in Paul's letter to Corinthians. For in one spirit we were all baptized into one body, Jews, Greeks, slaves, or free, and all were made to drink of one spirit. One of the things for which I've always been most grateful to my parents is my childhood. Thinking back, it seems almost idyllic. I always felt safe, loved, and perhaps most importantly, respected. I was trusted, and my feelings and opinions mattered. That's probably why I had the self-confidence to go out into the world expecting the same, and for the most part, receiving it. Only lately have I looked back with a new perspective, and that is one of how privileged I was. I'm not talking so much about monetary wealth. We were solidly middle class. I'm talking about growing up in a dominant culture in which I felt completely at home. My neighborhood, my schools, my church, my recreational pursuits were all almost exclusively white, as far as I can remember. Even though I was a preteen and teenager during the civil rights movement of the 60s, I don't recall any family discussions on race or any comments, positive or negative, about people of different races, ethnicities, or religions. Unfortunately, this meant that I also grew up pretty oblivious to the challenges faced by people of color or anyone who was different from what was considered the norm. Whiteness was assumed, unless we were told otherwise, and for the most part, I think it still is. My perspective began to change in college when I began to be exposed to more of the real world, working in some very diverse settings and seeing racism in action. But it was not until much later that I really began to understand the systemic racism in our society and my own privilege as a white person. The Rhode Island State Council of Churches course, Merciful Conversations on Race, opened my eyes even further, so that I am much more aware of how people of color have suffered from discrimination in so many of our institutions since the founding of this country, and how the cumulative effect of this has served to make progress very difficult. In the news recently, we've heard horrific stories from our history of the treatment of indigenous children torn from their families and culture, and of the destruction of black neighborhoods which had become economically successful, with accompanying loss of life. I never knew before that black soldiers were not able to access the benefits of the GI Bill after World War II due to multiple built-in factors creating even greater disparities in education, housing, and employment. Another source of my newfound understanding of race, systemic racism, its roots and its ongoing effects, was the book The Warmth of Other Suns, The Epic Story of America's Great Migration by Isabel Wilkerson. I highly recommend this fascinating, very readable book to anyone who seeks a better understanding of what people of color have faced for many decades. Also, the book Just Mercy, A Story of Justice and Redemption by Brian Stevenson, which I also highly recommend, is an eye-opening and very disturbing look into our justice system and its unfair treatment of the disadvantaged and disenfranchised. Through my greater awareness of the huge differences in how our society and institutions have treated different races going back to the founding of the country, I have become much more thoughtful in my response to events happening today. I am also more aware of the simple privileges I encounter every day, like not being nervous around police officers, shopping without fear of being watched, being able to get a loan from a bank if necessary, receiving the best in healthcare and education, and so on. To me, being white means getting the benefit of the doubt in most situations. And not only that, but being able to assume that I will get the benefit of the doubt. It also means being more likely to have the resources to deal with most situations that arise. And beyond that, it means that I am in the norm by which much is measured. If we accept whiteness as the norm, then where does that leave everybody else? But perhaps the most important lesson I've learned is that although I can never know what it feels like to be the victim of these prejudices and inequalities, I can listen, learn, and be aware. And then I can ask the question, can I help? And act based upon the answer.
Hear these words from the Gospel of Mark. When Jesus was asked which commandment was the first of all, his response was to love God. But then he said, the second is this, love your neighbor as yourself. There is no commandment greater than these. Good morning. My name is Yvette Souza. I've been attending Seekonk Congregational Church for about 15 years. Last March, I requested to join the MCOR sessions for a couple of reasons. Primarily, I wanted to be a part of the healing journey addressing the systemic racism so very prevalent in our country. But before I could really begin to do that, I needed to educate myself and truly understand the entire concept of white privilege. I needed to take a deep dive to fully grasp its meaning. I was unaware of its full essence. My family grew up in poverty. Most of my childhood, we had no car or phone. We always rented and moved a lot. There was no family home or wealth to pass down. It was hard to understand how I benefited from any legacy, for there was none, or so I thought. After I graduated from high school, I went right into the workforce. I was very lucky to get a good job right out of high school. I paid a couple dollars over the minimum wage, and I was able to work my way through promotions. It was similar for my husband. He emigrated from Portugal as a young child. His childhood had a lot of hurdles as well. Along with poverty, he had a language barrier and was a stranger in a whole new world. He also scored a great job right out of high school. We both attended college later in life while we were working full-time jobs. We were able to save some money, buy a house, and raise our family in this fine town of Seekonk. Just looking at that right there, had we have been of a different color, would we have gotten that job right out of high school? Would we have been able to work our way to a living wage? Knowing what I know now of the racism that is still very much embedded in our society, I can honestly say, probably not. I was beginning to become aware. There were many lessons I learned in the M4 series, and they were all about awareness. And to be brutally honest, mostly self-awareness. We had what we called aha moments. They were moments of perception or discovery that usually came after a blunder of some sort. I had a few. My biggest aha moment came during a discussion of pantyhose. One of the moderators was telling of an encounter she and a friend had during a shopping trip. Her friend, who had brown skin, had asked a department clerk for a pair of nude colored pantyhose. I am ashamed to say I instinctually thought of light colored pantyhose. It was then that I truly became aware that I see and think through a white lens. I thought of Crayola crayons and that crayon labeled flesh color and what it looked like. I felt ill. How had I not noticed that before? How could that have ever been okay? Jennifer, another moderator, talked about how Crayola came out with a new box of crayons just for skin colors and how every shade was represented. How happy she was to sit with her son and color with so many choices. I'm happy to say I am evolving. Recently, I was at a paint party with a group of friends who were painting a picture of a woman. Someone asked the instructor for more skin-colored paint, and this time I instantly thought, I wonder what shade she was looking for. They're baby steps, I know, but my hope is to drop that white lens and see clearly. I've become aware in other ways as well. A couple months ago, I was shopping for some items for Haiti. The Haiti Task Force was shipping a container filled with much-needed supplies. Fred, a dear friend, guide, and interpreter in Haiti, was to receive the container and distribute the supplies to various areas. I wanted to send something special to Fred's children. I went to Kohl's and was looking for a few cute outfits. I noticed some with princesses on them and began looking for some with brown or black skin. I could not find one outfit. They all had JoJo, or white Cinderella, or white children on them. I found myself feeling angry. I went over to the toy section. Surely I will find a black or brown Barbie in action figure, I thought. They had a line of professional Barbies. Not one of them had black or brown skin. A slow rage was beginning to simmer. I went over to the boys' action figures, and I did find one. He was a soldier with a mean expression on his face, carrying a weapon. I was horrified and so very sad I had not noticed this before. I know I could have tried another store or found something on Amazon, but it just should not be that hard to find children's items that represent skin colors other than white. I noticed these things now. Awareness was developing. I've evolved in other ways too. I purchased a group of stickers with the slogan, "Hate has no home here," and I'll put them in places where there's other stickers of graffiti perpetuating oppression. I find myself engaging in conversations I may have shied away from in the past. I tended to avoid conflict or not be confrontational. Recently, I was having such a conversation with a coworker. He was talking about how his neighborhood was changing. New families were moving in, and many of them were of color. He went on to say his new neighbors were nice, and they kept their properties up and seemed professional. But he and his wife were still considering moving because they just did not feel comfortable anymore. I looked at him and said, "Now you know what it feels like to be a minority, what it feels like to be the different one." I saw a change in the look in his eyes, and he said, "Yes, you're right," and he walked off deep in thought. I like to think maybe it was his aha moment. I know I could have gone on to a bigger lecture, but I didn't. But I like to think maybe, just maybe, I made a small impact there. Baby steps. In closing, I'd like to end with a small prayer. Will you pray with me? Dear strengthening and loving God, please empower me with the courage to speak up for those whose voices have been silenced, to notice and engage in worthy conversation with those whose eyes and ears and hearts have been dimmed to the mourning of your children, our brothers and sisters. To look deep within myself and face my own bias of viewing things through a white lens instead of a clear lens. for the awareness and courage to insert myself into actions that will help heal our communities and nation. In Jesus' precious name, I pray. Amen.
Thank you, ladies. Thank you very much. So, where do we go from here? Mission and Social Action will be delving into this topic for the greater part of this year. We have been reading books on the topic and having Zoom meetings. This past month, as you heard, we read Just Mercy by Brian Stevenson. Brian Stevenson was a young lawyer when he founded the Equal Justice Initiative, a legal practice dedicated to defending those most desperate and in need, the poor, the wrongly convicted, women and children trapped in the farthest reaches of our criminal justice system. This coming month, we are reading 400 Souls, edited by Ibram Kendi. This story begins in 1619 and goes to 2019. The editors assembled 90 brilliant writers, each of whom takes on a brief period of that 400 years. The writers explore their period through a variety of techniques, historical essays, short stories, and personal vignettes. Now, because this is a kind of a lengthy book, we've decided to do half a book at a time. So we would like all of you to participate with us with this book. And it's very readable. It's only like 3 to 5 pages per story. And the first meeting we're going to be having is the November 19th, Thursday night, and we will be meeting in church for this one, this time of year. So anyone interested in reading this book and participating in the book club discussion, please see me after the service, or you can contact me through the office. Thank you.
All who are able, please rise as we sing our hymn. Experience losses during these days.
and especially today we pray for the family of Peg Hopkins as her memorial committal was yesterday. Donnie, we will now share all of the community concerns and announcements.
Good morning.
Good morning.
We are so happy to have you all here with us here today on this beautiful, glorious, sunny morning. We are a faith community that lives out our faith together through all that we do. And we especially want you to know that your health, safety, and staying together are always our highest priority. And as part of our mission concern for the environment, we do continue to collect your Massachusetts bottles and cans. You can drop them off in the bins that are located at the back of the Farber Avenue parking lot anytime that is convenient for you. And also part of the Mission and Social Action Committee, they have been in touch with Dorcas International, who will be sponsoring 150 Afghan refugees. And as part of our mission, we will provide 20 sets of dining supplies, which includes plates, silverware, glasses, bowls, and other items. I'm going to include the complete list in my email this week, which will be either Tuesday or Wednesday. So please look out for that. And you can start to bring these items in next Sunday, or you can check with Maria and see when she's in the office. You can drop them off in the office. But this is going to be our part of helping the refugees come into the country. And if you have any questions, you can always see Betty Graham. We're using Betty Graham's name a lot today, so you can always see her if you have questions. And we continue to have non-perishable food available for anyone in need. Again, you can call Maria for her office hours, and you can go into the hall and into the office and pick up any supplies that you need. And we're very excited to say we are having a harvest supper this year, Saturday, November 6th. Yes, it is takeout only. The order form was included in my email this past week, as well as it's on our Facebook page. So you can start to place your orders at any time, and you will come in to get your items on November 6th between 1 and 3 in the afternoon, right in the parking lot over here. And we are having a Christmas bazaar on Saturday, December 4th, but that is also for pickup only. That form will be available in a few weeks. We thank you so much to so many of you that are paying your weekly pledges online. But we do have a plate over on the table when you came in that you can place your envelopes in each Sunday. And we are forever grateful for your generosity. And also, we're having a trunk or treat next Saturday night, October 23rd, from 4 to 6 p.m., again, in the Farber Avenue parking lot. It's free entry. You walk through the decorated car trunks and you receive candy. And there will be family activities and games and a snack bar. When you leave today, at the top of the ramp, you're going to see a board with items listed from Kristen that she needs for next Saturday. If you would like to purchase any of those items, take one of those slips, and there's a sheet of paper next to it. Just put your name next to the item so she knows that these items are being taken care of and she won't have to purchase them herself. So you can do that as you leave today. And also, you also have noticed that our confirmands are joining us today. Most of them, we have one in the front, most of them are in the back, but they have a task. They're given a blue sheet of paper every Sunday, and on that blue sheet of paper, they have to write down different things that are happening throughout the service. And one of their assignments this week is to greet someone they don't know and write their name at the bottom of their blue sheet. So maybe this week we can help them. If they haven't approached you, maybe you can approach them at the end of the service, give them your name, and they can put their name, your name, at the bottom of their slip. And we're very happy to have them with us every Sunday. Please enjoy a week. Wear your mask or ask. Be safe. Please continue to reach out to others. This is so very important. There are still a lot of homebound people, and we need to reach out to them. I hope that you remain in good health and spirits, and I will see you again next week. And thank you to the guitar choir and Alice on the organ for providing all of the music today. And now please welcome them as they sing Sisters and Brothers.
Thank you.
indeed we could all get together and love one another and we come now to our communion together. In communion with those of all times and all places. We come to the table of our Lord Jesus Christ, bringing the gifts of all that we are and all that we hope to be. Let us gather our hearts first in the spirit of prayer. Let us pray. In this, your presence, gracious and giving God, we come. We come bringing all of our unsettling fears and all of our gifts of giving thanks. We come in need of your persevering strength and security, and also your ongoing presence right here on our everyday journeys. Be with us, guide us. Hear all of the prayers that rise up from the depths of our own hearts. Be with all of those lifted up in our prayer concerns, both close and distant. All who need your strength and your courage in the midst of doubts or despairing. And we pray that you'll be with us, O God, in our understandings and newer understandings of racism, and how each of us can make a difference as we live our lives by faith. And loving God, wherever we find ourselves, we pray that you'll fill us with the promise that you are ever present and guiding us with the power to be filled with your light of integrity and truth-telling, with your gifts of compassion and serving, with the focus of caretaking for all and the commitment to live with a passion for justice and mercy. We ask now, O God, that you will bless this cup and this bread, and each one of us receiving in the holy name of Jesus Christ, who taught us when we pray together to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Your friends, we remember how on that night when Jesus was betrayed, he took the bread, and giving thanks, blessed it, and broke it, saying, This is my body, broken for you. Do this always, remember me. Same manner also Jesus took the cup, and giving thanks, blessed it, and said, This cup is the cup of the new covenant, which is the covenant of love. Do this also, remembering you. Ministering now in Christ's name, I invite all to share the bread and cup, and while partaking, may we all sing Hallelujah, Hallelujah, give thanks to the risen Christ.
meaningful statement related to the message of racism. He said, "We are not afraid," and the young people taught everybody else a lesson. All the older people that had learned how to compromise and learned how to take it easy and be polite, to get along and leave things as they were, the young people taught us all a lesson.
Into our room. Let the people say, Amen.
Amen.
Go with peace.